worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened, worshipless Buddha, consummated in knowledge and behavior.
Hello to you, friends. This is Dhamma on Air number 122 in frosty, cold sunshine in Denmark in late January month, and you are indeed welcome here, and thank you for your attention.
Friends, Kolis is all being. This imploding vacuum personality is void of any self. The Blessed Buddha explained this passing transience of existence as void like this. Suppose a man with good sight observed the many bubbles in the Ganges River as it drifted along. Then, by carefully watching and examining them all, then, after he had carefully examined them, they would appear to him empty, evanescent, void, and unsubstantial. In exactly the same way does a bhikkhu observe all material phenomena, all feelings, all perceptions, all mental constructions, and all states of consciousness, whether they be past, present, or future, far or near, as bubbles, by carefully watching, analyzing, and examining them all, they appear to him as empty, void, without any core. Regarding these impersonal processes, any action is without an actor. Neither agent nor actor exists, only egoless acting processes unfolds. Ask not who, but what. Who feels? Nobody feels. What feels? Feeling itself feels. What does feeling feel? Feeling feels pain, pleasure, and neutral indifference. Who perceives? Nobody perceives. What perceives then? Perception itself perceives. What does perception perceive? Perception perceives, receives, records, forms, colors, sounds, smells, tastes, touches, ideas, thoughts, and mental states. Who recognizes? Nobody cognizes. What then cognizes? Consciousness itself cognizes. What does consciousness recognize? Consciousness cognizes feelings, perceived experiences, and all the other various mental states as joys, anger, jealousy, generosity, and so forth. These imprints arise and cease incessantly. Observable is this. This auditory consciousness that you're hearing this with arise and cease right there. With the end of this word, no lasting same self can ever reside or remain within this fleeting transience. In this passing flux of discrete mental states, exactly like when the single still pictures of a rolling film momentarily passes in between the lens and the lamp, causing a blinking projection to appear as real, or here, or there, on the screen of consciousness, then neither a feeler, nor an experiencer, nor an observing agent can be found, assumed, constructed, concluded, or deposited. No one is in or behind, neither the film nor the mental projection, just this blinking projection itself is, and that only for a very short moment. Just like we cannot conclude from the two facts that there is a cinema, and there's a film projected inside this cinema, we cannot conclude that there actually are anybody inside the cinema. As the external town, city, cinema very well may be all empty of any audience. Similar with this internal cinema of mere experience of consciousness is also empty of any self, empty of any person, empty of any soul, empty of any entity, empty of any observer, apart from the projected passing experience itself. Where actually is this ego, this adored yet imaginary self then hiding? Is the self identical with the body? No. Is the self hidden inside the body? No. Is the self outside or apart from the body? No. Does the self own and possess a body? No. Does the body own and possess a self? No. There's just this frame of a body, but no self as controller of it. Is the self identical with the feeling? No. Is the self hidden inside the feeling? No. Is the self outside and apart from the feeling? No. Does the self own and possess a feeling? No. Does the feeling own and possess a self? No. There's just this sensation of feeling, but no self as a feeler. Is the self identical with the perception, the experience? No. Is the self hidden inside the perceived experience? No. Is the self then outside and apart from the perceived experience? No. Does the self own and possess a perceived experience? No. Does the experience own and possess a self then? No. There's just this moment of experience, a moment of perception, but no self as experiencer or observer. Is the self identical with the mental construction? No. Is the self hidden inside the mental constructions? No. Is the self outside, apart from the mental construction? No. Does the self own and possess mental construction? No. Does the mental construction own and possess a self then? No. There's just this activity of mental construction. But there's no self as a constructor. Is the self then identical with consciousness? No. Is the self hidden inside the consciousness? No. Is the self outside, apart from consciousness? No. Does the self own and possess a consciousness? No. Does the consciousness own and possess a self? No. There's just these fleeting moments of aware consciousness, but no self being conscious inside there. Why not? Because all these phenomena arise, change and cease. If the proposition of a self is taken as confirmed, then one should say, this identical, same and unchanging self should arise, change and cease in every moment, which is absurd, contradictory and inconsistent with any concept which we identify with as myself. How can a so-called same self arise as new and cease in each moment? If the self is not the same, it is then changed into another self. Any self who is another self is clearly an inconsistent, absurd fantasy. Is the self then a collective conglomerate of body, feeling, experience and consciousness? No. Why not? If the self is not found within any of the parts, it cannot either be found within any collections of the very same parts. In conclusion, all egoism is based on an assumed and long cherished and reinforced idea of an agent inside, labeled as the self, which does not exist except as an idea, a mental construction, which beings fall in love with and violently defend. This outer romance has taken place in all the prior rebirths, also when animal or insect, or deer. So it's a long, reinforced, bad habit. The ego is a really bad habit because it's a falsehood that is more than fatal. Why so? Because it drags beings back into rebirth and thus repeated death. This assumed, non-existent, hypothetical, self-agent identity, soul, or personality does not exist as an unchanging entity or reality. Freed of such self-possession, freed of such self-obsession, one is freed of the first hindrance, blocking stream entry, namely personality belief, Sakaya Ditti. Buddha once said, "Blissful is solitude for one who's content, learned, and who sees the true Dhamma. Blissful is harmlessness towards all beings without exception. Blissful is freedom from any sensual urge whatsoever. Yet the supreme bliss is the elimination, this abysmal self-deception I am." Dana, Inspiration 2-1. This, the Buddhist doctrine of no self, is called anatta. The best way to comprehend no self is to begin with observing and reflecting on impermanence, anicca, and suffering, dukkha. Then eventually one comes to understand whatever is always otherwise and never the same, never identical with itself, cannot ever be an identity, the same self. What is always, ultimately speaking, suffering cannot be under control of a self, since if it were, then the self would, by this control, change it into something pleasant and happy. But no self can do that, since it is not, apparently, in full control. If the self is not in control of even itself, what is then in control? Can it then be a self if it's not in control of itself? If it has no autonomy? No. It is just conditions that plays out their cause and effects. May all come to see that and be calmed and released. Thereby, it's subtle, it's complicated, yet it is true and freeing. Ownerlessness is a universal characteristic of all being. Impersonal are all states and phenomena, without a core, void of self and substance. If one feels a bit dizzy, or maybe slight fear, when rigorously attempting to comprehend egolessness, then one is going in the right direction. Keep digging there. Worth noticing it is one can never lose a self that never was there in the first place. That never was there in the first place. Thank you.
Hello to you, friends. This is indeed Dhamma on Air number 122. Recorded January 2019 in crispy frost. There are three questions, but first the normal intro. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Samma Sambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the Blessed Buddha. Question 369. When I first meet someone, I'm very lighthearted in our conversations, and in a way I treat them
But as we come a bit closer, and the more we act, I clamp down and become more serious and less lighthearted. Everything is more serious, there's more at stake, and I become very careful and not fun at all. How do I overcome this attachment issue? How do I keep it light? How can I maintain a carefree heart when nothing is deadly, where nothing is deadly serious? Yes, I would say this is close to impossible, because it requires actually not wanting this company or whatever issue it is. Because any desire leads to a clinging. And as soon as there's clinging, then there's also fear of losing or of not getting. And as soon as there's fear of losing or not getting, not achieving, then there is this anxiety and this agitation, which leads to panic further down the road. So it is par excellence, the second noble truth, that craving always creates suffering, that is in action here. As soon as you want the partner, or want the company, or want the job, then you also start clinging to it, even before getting it. Want the human state, even before getting it. So even before getting it, one starts fear losing it. So if that's not a prime example of the second noble truth, craving causes suffering in action, then I don't know what is. I don't know what it is. You've not even clutched the object yet. Then one starts fear losing it, and one becomes mum and stiff and in full of anxiety and not charming and fun at all. So not wanting it, not needing it, not urging for it keeps any relation light and without fear. Blissful is being without passions in this world. Blissful is overcoming of all sense desires, said the Buddha. Udana 2:1. And in the fire sermon to somebody who was fire worshippers, the blessed Buddha once said, he was staying at Gaya's head together with 1,000 bhikkhus. Bhikkhus, all this is burning. And what bhikkhus is that all that is burning? The eye, the ear, the nose, the tongue, the body, and the mind is burning. All forms, sounds, smells, flavors, touches, and mental states are also burning. Whatever kind of conscious sensation that this causes, that is also burning. Any feeling arising caused by that contact, whether pleasant, painful, or neutral, that too is burning. Burning with what? I tell you, burning with the fire of lust, hate, and ignorance. Burning with birth, burning with aging, burning with death, burning with sadness, disappointment, frustration, and burning with suffering. The fireman sermon, Samyutta Nikaya, book 4, 19-20. So, as soon as there's this craving, burning for sensuality, sense desire, kama chanda, kama raga, sensual lust, then there inevitably will be this fear, this stiffness of mind, and this subtle anxiety and fear of losing that is connected with this. It is inevitably, as soon as there's no craving, no desire, no wanting, no urging, not even hoping for, then there's freedom, there's bliss, there's calm, there's a relaxed attitude towards the object, whether alive or not, whether human or not, or whether it's just a situation or a material state. So, it comes almost without saying that this bliss of being without sense desire, kamachanda, and being without lust, kamaraga, for sensuality, not only sexuality, but for seeing, for hearing, for tasting, for touching, for smelling, for ideation, that this is the only way. That's the only way. As soon as there's this urge, then there's agitation, and then also fear of losing. And this means anxiety. And anxiety, fear of losing, and agitation cannot coexist with suffering, cannot coexist with happiness. It is a form of suffering, of course. So the ultimate solution is awakening itself, eradicating all form of desire. In this regard, a young deity, Subrahma, once asks the blessed Buddha, "Always frightened is this mind. Always troubled is this mind. Always agitated is this mind. about present problems, about future problems. Is there a release from this worry and anxiety? Please then explain it to me right now. Whereupon the Blessed Buddha, he explained this Brahmadeva coming from a very fairly high state. He simply declared, I see no other real safety for any living being except from control of the senses, except from the relinquishment of all, except from awakening into enlightenment. I see no other real safety for any living being except from control of the senses, except from relinquishing all sensuality, except from awakening into enlightenment. Samyutta Nikaya 1, Book 54, Sagada, verses, the verses where he speaks with God, various kinds of gods and deities. So, that more or less habit, one has to relinquish all states, basically, in the sense that one is not craving for them. And not craving for any state, whether any past state, future state, or present state, then there will be bliss, then there will be freedom. This actually is a synonym of awakening, not craving for anything, not craving for any form of sensuality, not craving for seeing anything, hearing anything, smelling anything, tasting anything, touching anything, or experiencing anything with the mind, not craving for any form of becoming, becoming rich, poor, divine, enlightened, not craving for any form of non-becoming, non-becoming old, sick, dead, disrespected, and so forth. Not craving for anything whatsoever. That makes sets the mind free, because then it loses this fear, this anxiety, this agitation. And without fear, without anxiety, without agitation, then there is peace. Then there is an opportunity for bliss to arise. The last question, 370. What is the Buddhist opinion about doing sport, exercise? Yeah, exercise is good. Walking meditation was warmly recommended by the Buddha, because then you can go from place to place, and at the same time you are doing walking meditation, then you will train up your awareness, your acute awareness, step by step, by step, by step, by step. And acute awareness is always good. Then there's this doing sport for competition, and then it is not so good, because any winning, it gives rise to pride and arrogance and an overblown ego. And losing, this gives rise to despair and self-depreciation, as if hit with an arrow. So, as the Buddha say in the Sagama Sutta, after a battle between two kings, Pasenadi and Ajatasattu, then he said, winning gives birth to hostility. Losing, one lies down in pain. The calmed lie down with ease, having set both winning and losing aside. Samyutta Nikaya 3.14 Sagama Sutta. Winning gives birth to hostility. Losing, one lies down in pain. The calmed lie down with ease, having set both winning and losing aside. So there, if you say, winning and losing is futile, only winning over your own mind, conquering your own mind, conquering your own suffering, then there's winning of a battle that is not connected with overblown ego and arrogance. And arrogance always falls down. Pride always falls down. Once you ditch this pride, there's no ego to be proud of in the first place. The sun and the light is going away, and the animals are going to bed, I can hear. So I will say thanks again for your advantageous attention, your clever consideration, and your kind contribution. Thanks to all the Dayakas supporters, and especially the directly monthly donors. And then, last but not least, have a nice and noble day. Namo Tassa Bhagavato. arahato, samma sambuddhassa, worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened, was the blessed Buddha. Remember to click subscribe there, the bell there, and like there if you like. Thank you.
You heard Bhikkhu Sammahita from the Cypress Hermitage on the Knuckles Mountain, Pamparela, Central Hill Country, Sri Lanka. Please subscribe to the Google group Buddha Direct and visit the website whatbuddhasaid.net. May all beings become thus happy thereby. Thank you. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha. As the next Buddha, the noble Arya Ajitamitaya will say, you can come as you like, but you pay as you go. Thank you for your contribution and help. And nice.